Welcome. Each one of you, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, each one of you, remember, you're a child of God. God has made you. God has desired that you'd be here this morning to hear His word. God wants you to be ready to receive Him when He comes. And so I believe this morning that as we hear the word of God, let's be ready to receive that word as it comes from God. But we welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ.
I kind of want to hide behind the plants. But I want to come out from the pulpit a little and engage with you guys this morning. It's so good to see every one of you here. There are so many of you that are here as an answer to prayer. And I'm not going to embarrass anyone, but you might know who you are. But just thank God that you're here. Not because you get to hear me, but because you're a living hope. And there hasn't been a church where I have worshiped so powerfully, so regularly as a living hope. And I just thank God for our branch. I thank God for each one of you. Two weeks ago, I had a privilege of speaking in Excelsior Springs, and there were seven people there. And I don't think we remember how hard it is to worship with such a small group. We're really blessed. But this morning, I want to share with you some things that, I don't know, I feel like I was born to share, because in our patriarchal blessing, it listed that I have the gift of faith, which I'm going to talk about, and the gift of love, which I'm going to talk about. So, I would appreciate your attention. For an opening scripture, I'm going to read from Hebrews 11:1. And you're probably sitting there saying, he's going to talk about faith. Of course, he's going to share Hebrews 11:1. And how many hundreds of times have you heard this? Well, you know, growing up in the church, I heard this 100 times. And I never understood it. I still don't understand it. But I'm going to read it to you this morning, because it's like compulsory if they're going to talk about faith. So, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So like the scripture that Jack read this morning about right early, I don't know what the 16th century guys were thinking of when we translated this, but this wording doesn't really make any sense to me. So let's think about faith in a different way. If you read through the 11th chapter, it goes on to talk about some real notable guys in the scriptures: Noah, Isaac, Enoch, Abraham, Jacob, Moses, and some of their stories, if you think about what was going on, you really understand what faith may really be about. Not just an evidence of things not seen, because how can it be evidence if you don't see it? I don't understand that to me. So, you know, what was it with Noah? So, Noah was a man who was about 480 years old when God called him to preach repentance and to build an ark. Now, Jack is, how old are you? You're over 80, right? So add another 400 years onto Jack, and now he's going to go build a boat. He was out chopping wood with us yesterday, so maybe that's possible. But can you imagine what it would have been like for Noah? I mean, he heard the voice of God, and he had faith. It was, he did that. How old was he when it started to rain? He was 600 years old, so do some math, like Bob did. 600 minus 4, 120 years. 120 years, so 40 years longer than Jack's been alive. Noah was building the boat and preaching the word. Now, in all of that time, did he have opportunity to say, God, you really mean this? God, you really need me? God, you really need to take examples? God, God, do you believe that you're going to wipe the earth with a flood? But there was something about faith. There was something about his commitment to being a child of God that kept him going and focused. Noah was all in. What would the ark have been like if it looked like the Death Star from Revenge of the Jedi, but it was kind of half there, you know? That wouldn't have been a very good boat, would it? You know, with the bottom section kind of undone, water coming in, bailing all the time. No, God, Noah was all in for God. 120 years. How about Abraham? Remember the story of Abraham? He and his wife had longed for a son. They had been childless through most of their life, and when Abraham was 99 years old, Abraham was really old. Gosh, what's the deal, God? God gave him a son. He was Isaac, and he was the pride of his life. God told Abraham to take Isaac up to the mountain and offer him as a sacrifice. They went up there, and Abraham laid Isaac on the altar. Now, what do you think was going through Isaac's mind? Run. But yet, didn't he have some faith? Doesn't he get some credit in the story? Sure, of course. But Abraham was all in. He was going to give the pride and joy of his life to the Lord. He was going to sacrifice his son that he had waited 100 years for to God. His belief in God wasn't just, you know, I'm going to pay some tithing, I'm going to attend church, you know, once a week, and then, 30 minutes a week I'm going to give the Lord. He was all in, wasn't he? And I'm going to use that phrase over and over and over because it, to me, describes how completely committed and devoted we are to the Lord. How about Daniel? Daniel isn't necessarily mentioned in Hebrews 11, but it does talk about people throwing in the dens of wild animals. So let's talk about Daniel. If you go to the book of Daniel, you can read about him, and he had three colleagues there, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And a few months ago, and in song service, I talked a little bit about them. But as I was studying their story, a couple of things jumped out to me. First of all, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were among the young men who had told the king that they didn't want to eat the certain food, that they wanted to eat their porridge, their gruel, their oatmeal, their rice cakes, whatever it might have been. They were going to do that instead of the steak and potatoes and the cheesecake that the king had offered. And at the end of a certain time, they were going to see who was healthier and who was fittest. As somebody who enjoys steak and potatoes and cheesecake, I tell you, I'm not very fit. So we know how that ended. But that example sets the stage that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were men of God. And what happened? Well, King Nebuchadnezzar had this statue, and then at the sound of the trumpet and all these musical instruments, everyone was to bow down and worship the statue and worship the king Nebuchadnezzar. And when that happened, there were three people who did it. Four, but probably Daniel was in the room, I guess. And in the third chapter of Daniel, we're starting at verse 16, we read the following. Well, because of course the law said that if you didn't bow down, you were going to have consequence. So he said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. I love the way that's worded. Because those three guys stood before the king with boldness, and they said, hey, we're not going to make up some business. We're not going to give you, you know, what we think you might want to hear. We're going to really tell you what's going on. We weren't careful. They weren't going to mince their words, if you will. Verse 17, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thy hand, O king. But if it not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the gold image that you have set up. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are going to be all in. They're going to be all in the furnace here in about 5 minutes. And what did they say? is that we have faith, we believe that God will save us. But if he doesn't, doesn't matter. If he doesn't save us, we're going to die knowing that we trusted the Lord. Sometimes, friends, the God of the universe doesn't move every mountain for us in our lives. Sometimes bad things happen to good people. What happened to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Well, the king got mad. They were three little pipsqueaks, three little runts from a captured country who had vested them some time back with their diet. And they were challenging his authority, his rule. So what did he tell them? He said, "Hey, heat this furnace up seven times hotter than it ever been heated." Now, how did the furnace not melt to the ground? I mean, as an engineer, I've never designed something with seven times factor safety. So that is one hot furnace. And then it says that the guys that threw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego died because when they opened the door, you know, some flame came out, but seven times the flame came out, and it killed them. And I've often wondered, the deliverance had already occurred at that point. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego should have died with the guys that were throwing them in there. Have you ever thought about that? But they were all into their faith. They didn't say, "Well, we hope God is going to deliver us. We think that he might." They're like, "Hey, if he doesn't, we're still going to believe." And then it goes on to talk about that there were four people in there. And King Nebuchadnezzar was humbled and realized that the God of Israel was not to be trifled with. So what a marvelous story of faith and being so committed. And a couple chapters later, Daniel interprets some dreams, and he has some success in the court of the king, and he doesn't escape the notice of the other people that were in the kingdom that were his advisors. They would get upset with Daniel. So even after the experience of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they sort of tricked the king, and Daniel found himself in a tough position.